This is the electronic simulation is online. It's actually got some bugs in it and not working the way it's supposed to right now, but I'll just go and show you some of the way in which we, this is a standard run of the average African immigration to the United States, or to the Americas, sorry about that, in the 1750s. There's all the input data. Here's a look at the African source population, so that looks a lot like the pyramid that I showed you before. These are the captors. There's the total African population in year one. Then we come back in year 40, and we look at the source population, and it's lost a lot of both male and females. And the captor population has continued to grow. And then here's the population of the captors plus those people who they have captured and held in slavery. And you'll see there's a lot more on the female than on the male side. And there's lots of children, because the children come from the female slaves as well as free. I hit end, and I'm paying the price for that. Year 40, here we are, this group here. Okay, and then this is the whole regional population. Then we magnify a little bit. This is a look at the population of those enslaved and held in Africa after 40 years. This is the look at the population of those enslaved and held overseas. And that, this population you see is mostly male and mostly young adults, but some people get old and there's kids born into it. And so one interesting thing is the relationship between this African population, which is built up, African slave population built up as a byproduct of the export slave trade, right? I'm assuming, and I think the data are likely to sustain this, that those who were enslaving just grabbed people. You know, they focused on young adults, but they just grabbed males and females. But the market for male slaves was overseas. And then there developed a market for female slaves locally. 2 minutes. Okay. Well, so in any case, we also get to look at, these are the captives themselves as they go. And so that's the, there's one that's worth doing. These are the captives as they get on the boat, these as they get off the boat. So that's an indication of the mortality amongst them. Okay, well, that was a quick look, but that's gone now. So let me go back into the main show and see if I can get any place near to finished. This is a look at some of the output results done over time, and it shows for the Bight of Benin, so back in the area I started working on, these are the numbers of slaves sent out from each region. This is the estimated population, which is shown to be declining until after 1850. And up top is shown estimates of the sex ratio. So something on the order of 70 males per 100 females amongst the adults, where it's expected to be the proportions at that time. Now, I showed you the comparison of the African and export slave groups. This is works fine for the 18th century. But there's a new the problem I always knew about, but it's become important in the historiography. In the 19th century, the export slave trade died down, but the enslavement of people in Africa continued. And there's a controversy going on, especially in France, in which they have passed a law that declares the Atlantic slave trade to be a crime against humanity. And on the other hand, there are those who feel injured by that sort of a suggestion, and they have gone and dug up African slave statistics and are arguing there were more people in slavery in Africa at the end of the 19th century than were sent across the Atlantic in earlier times. So what's the big deal? The problem with slavery and with the political implication is about all of these Africans rather than European slave traders. All right, so this is a different but related problem, one that I feel it's necessary to address and try to make sense of. And it exceeds the power of this methodology because I don't have any nice, simple ways to predict how many people would be enslaved in Africa.